So good morning, everyone, and Ron and Tatura, thanks for organizing this course. And we're going to talk about Torah Tarel. I think Torah Tarel is probably one of the most important advances in chiropractic and refractive surgery that I've encountered over my career. And I'll start as soon as my machine unfreezes. So I'll just have to go back. And try again. And the topic Ron gave me today for this course is mastering the Barrett-Torrie calculator. Now I'm going to talk more in general about the philosophy of astigmatism management and perhaps some of the more subtle aspects of the Barrett-Torrie calculator. So before I actually start my talk, I was wondering, by a show of hands in the audience, if you can put your hand up if you use Torah Tarels in maybe 10% of your cases. 10%? What about 20%? 30%? 40%? 50%, 60%, 70%, 80%, 90%. All right, so that's interesting. We'll ask the question a bit later in the course as well. So I began Torah Lenses in 2006. This is just a very simple analysis comparing results in 2006 to 10 years later in 2016. So the dark blue is the pre-op coronary cylinder, the light blue is the post-op refractive cylinder, and the green is just the change. Very simple analysis. But if you look from 2006 to 2016, a few things are apparent. So one, my threshold cylinder for when I do toric RLs has dropped. Two, you can see that the light blue is smaller, so my outcomes have improved. But the most dramatic change is from using toric RLs in maybe 10% of my cases, like most of you in 2006, I now use my toric RLs in at least 80% of all my cases. So this is really a paradigm shift. And the first myth I'd like to dispel is that there really is any benefit in leaving a patient with residual astigmatism. The idea that leaving someone with residual astigmatism will help their depth of focus for near vision or intermediate is a myth. There's no data to support that. So the only benefit you get from myopic astigmatism is the myopic spherical equivalent in focus. And it's better to be minus a half sphere than minus one sil. This is a myth which is deeply embedded in lots of ophthalmologists' psyche, and there's nothing to support that myth. And furthermore, even small amounts of astigmatism, a half, three quarters, have been shown to reduce contrast, have been shown to reduce reading speed. In fact, if you look at one of the most important correlations of satisfaction after cataract surgery, correlates very well with astigmatism, highly correlated. If you're going to use toric lenses in about 80% of the cases, you need accurate outcomes. And for accurate outcomes, you need to consider measurements, incisions, and alignments. And I'll talk about each of those topics in turn. So firstly, regarding measurements, there's a lot of confusion. People say, well, I don't want to use toric lenses because I don't know how to measure it and I need so many devices. But actually, if you want to target less than a half in all your patients, I think three instruments is ideal. I think a barometer and a topographer are essential. But a third instrument, such as a keratometer, is often helpful. And really, most of you may have those instruments already. So not a huge investment needed in instruments. It used to be a lot easier in the 19th century. For almost 100 years, the only instrument that was available to measure the corneal surface was the Jeval keratometer. So life was easy for the 19th, early 20th century ophthalmologists. It's more confusing today because we still have the Jeval keratometer, but we also have topographers, Scheinflug, the cedar-based topographers, and multiple barometers. But the same principle of combining primary and secondary instruments for keratometry, combining instruments that was established with navigation in the early 18th, 19th century, is still relevant today. So what we're talking about is combining instruments to get a combined K, what I call an integrated K. But it's not so straightforward with Ks from different instruments, because when you calculate the mean or the median, because they're vectors, they have magnitude and direction, you can't use simple summation to add them up and divide by two or three. It requires vector maths, vector summations. So it's a little more complex.
There are seats in front for those just coming in.
When you're trying to combine the measurements from different instruments. I did a study where I looked at patients who had their Ks measured with different instruments, two barometers, Lenstar, Master 500, a Pentacam. I used their pre-op measurements, their pre-op Ks. And what's important, I used and measured in a month what the alignment of the lens actually was. And then I calculated the predicted error in residual astigmatism, first looking at each individual device. Lenstar, Armaster, and Pentacam. And in this analysis, looking at just single devices, the Lenstar proved to be more accurate than either the Armaster or the Pentacam. But I then calculated the error in predicted residual astigmatism using the mean K from a combination of different devices. So I combined Armaster, Lenstar, Lenstar, Pentacam, etc. And the most accurate outcome was when I used the mean K from all three devices, 75.8%. But you can see, even adding the Pentacam to the Armaster or the Pentacam to the Lenstar improved each of those single devices. But the best result in this analysis was when I looked at the median K from all three devices, Lenstar, Armaster, and Pentacam. And the median is a very powerful tool. It's a statistical analysis which tends to de-emphasize outliers. And this proved to be the most effective way of combining Ks and deriving what I call an integrated K. So if you go online and use the Baratello calculator, there's been a change to more recently, version 1.15, and there's something called the K calculator. So you have to enter your data, press calculate, and only then can you access the K calculator. So it's not active until you put your data in and press calculate. And you see here, you now have the opportunity to enter up to the Ks from up to three different devices. And you can look at what the integrated K is from individual devices, but it really gets interesting when you select multiple devices. So if you select two devices, such as Armaster and Lenstar, then the integrated K above will be the mean K of those two devices. But if you select three devices, then the integrated K above will be the median K of all three devices. So the method of combining will vary depending if you select two or three different Ks.
Can I just interrupt you? So the median K that is picked up then, is that just straight off the median value, or is there still some math behind it?
No,
changes
no.
Those numbers.
It's a median value. It's a vector mean. You can't
just take the
guess
median.
What the median is,
right.
Because it's including the axis.
Yeah.
So sometimes it'll be intuitive. So I could have guessed that. That's the middle one. But not always, because the median is an integration not just of the magnitude of the K, but the direction of the K. So it's not something that you can derive simplistically with a calculator or intuitively. Now when you then press calculate and you go back to the patient near you, you'll see that the integrated K has been entered automatically in the main K's of the calculator. But the question arises, can you use this newly integrated K for the sphere, the spherical power of the lens? Because the barophore calculator is different than many calculators, it gives you the spherical power as well. Or should you go to the upper right-hand corner of the calculator and put in separate K's, say from your favorite barometer? Because with this toric calculator, you can have K's used for the toric prediction and a separate K used for the spherical prediction. So do you have to do that? And to look at that, I then did another study, but this time looking at the spherical error in prediction, not the toric. And I found the same thing, that the best spherical prediction was using the median K from three devices. So not just for the toric prediction, but for the spherical prediction. Now the differences, the improvement is not as great as with the toric prediction, but what I'm telling you is that you can use the integrated K not only for the toric prediction, but also for the spherical prediction. Because it's at least as good, or even better, than using the K's from a single barometer. So you don't have to use that separate field for optional K's. You can just use the integrated K as well. So what I'm showing you is that this concept of an integrated K, which is available in the K calculator, is an alternative workflow, but it really simplifies the interpretation of K. This is one of the challenging parts of doing toric lenses. You sit there with two or three devices and you wonder, what the hell do I use, because I'm different. And especially when the levels are low, low astigmatism, that's when the K's often differ a lot. Not only does it simplify your life, but it improves the prediction of your toric outcomes. Well, I want to show you another hidden gem of the toric calculator, which may not be evident unless you scratch below the surface, and that is the measured posterior cornea, measured PCA. Well, we have devices today which measure the posterior cornea. We have shunt hook devices and a new generation of swift source OCT. So several barometers today, such as Armosa 700, device, have the ability to measure the axial length and other aspects, including the posterior cornea, using swift source OCT. But if you've had experience or you look at the literature, you'll realize that measuring the posterior cornea gives pretty poor results, not anywhere near as good as you would expect. And I think the missing link in that jigsaw is not just the measurement of the posterior cornea, but using that measurement properly within different formulae. So the Barrett formula, essentially, is a Gaussian formula. It's a thick lens formula. And it's a Gaussian formula from all aspects of prediction, including the cornea. And when you measure K's, keratometry with a keratometer, you just measure the anterior surface. So how do keratometers account for the posterior surface? Well, they use the so-called keratometer index, 1.3375. It's just kind of a fudge that takes into account the posterior cornea. And that's all the original toric calculators, the lens formulae, that was the basis for the calculation. More sophisticated management of the cornea is, say, with my own formula, because it's a Gaussian formula, and the equation is there for the posterior cornea. If you don't measure the posterior cornea, but it uses the Gould strand ratio, the assumed ratio of the posterior cornea to the anterior cornea within that formula. But now you see an opportunity to create a customized version of the Barrett formula and toric calculator, where you replace those assumed values with the measured posterior radius of the formula. So, you know, a lot of these devices have TK values or true net corneal power values. But I'm not interested in those values. I just want the posterior cornea itself. And so I did a study. This is in 100 eyes, comparing standard calculators, such as a Holo calculator, looking at conventional Ks or the pentacam, true net corneal power. And I looked at my own formula, the Daratari calculator, because version 2 allows you to select a prediction based on the measured posterior cornea or the predicted posterior cornea. So you can compare the outcome of those two modes of calculation. 100 eyes, and this is using post-op Ks now, as well as the measured axis of the lens, and I'm looking at the predicted error in residual astigmatism. This is quite a busy slide, but just look at the percentage within the half doctor. Can you see that line there? So the holiday standard calculator, the low pressure point, 32% within the half doctor of predicted residual astigmatism. If you use the true net corneal power, it improves a little bit, 39%, that's what's been published, hardly worth the effort. If you use the Daratari calculator with the measured posterior cornea, it's pretty good, 70%. If you use a predicted posterior cornea, which is the traditional method I use, it's actually a little bit better. But what I want to show you when you look at the graph, showing you the same things, standard holiday with true net power, that the measured and the predicted are very close. At the moment, predicted still seems a little bit better, but there's no statistical difference between the measured and the predicted posterior cornea. Gives you almost as good a prediction. And I did another study more recently. This is in 80 eyes using Swift Source OCT. This is used in the Zeiss Almaster 700. And this is the outcome. And it's almost the same as I showed you with the earlier study using Scheinfurth. So once again, it varies from 48%, a little bit better with the TK power, but not much, 53%. But once you use the Daratari calculator, either the measured posterior cornea, 83.8%, or the predicted posterior cornea, 91.3% in the half delta. But once again, both measured and predicted, there's no statistical difference. So either method would be useful in predicting toric outcomes. And there's the graph, again, with the appropriate statistical analysis. And this is a masterclass, so it's not just a one-way transfer, but it's a two-way transfer. So anything I say which doesn't make sense, you need to ask afterwards. You can even stop in between if you want. It's a small group, now's the time. Don't walk away from this course with things that you don't understand, because some is quite complex. Ask the questions. So when you go to your calculator and you press calculate, a little menu will appear, predicted or measured PCA. You don't have to use measured, you can just leave the default, predicted PCA. When you then press calculate and display the lens, you'll get the theoretical prediction. As I said, at the moment, if anything, it's not just as good, it may be a little better. And it will show you that it's giving you the measured PCA.
Grant, can I just ask a question here? So the predicted currently is better than the measured one. Have you actually ever back calculated for the outliers that we still occasionally get and put in a measured PCA to see whether it would have been better?
So I suspect that for unusual corneas, maybe keratoconus, something like that, perhaps the measured will be better. But guess what? We're up to 91% with the predicted. It's going to be hard. You're going to need not just 10 cases, but a decent number of cases. So that's only 80 cases. So to get 10 or 15 unusual corneas, I'll need 500 cases. Now we'll get there eventually. And I suspect for those unusual cases, perhaps the measured will be better, but I don't have data yet, because to collect that data, well, it's ongoing, but we don't have it as yet. But when you go back to your patient, you can select the measured pressure point. And guess what? A new menu will appear. And you don't put in the TK value or the true corneal net power, whatever they call it. You just want the posterior radius of the cornea. And you can either put the radius or the power of the posterior cornea. You can select either one. And then when you select calculate, that value will be entered into the CADS. It will show you what the magnitude of the posterior cornea is. But you must put in the device that you measured the posterior cornea in, because the algorithm is not just using the posterior cornea on its own. There's an algorithm to optimize that information, and it's device specific. So it's more complex than just putting the posterior cornea. There has to be an optimization as well. We'll talk about that for those that are interested afterwards. But then when you press calculate and you display the toric lens, the prediction will be calculated based on the measured posterior cornea. And it will show you that in that little display. So it'll tell you not only if you use measured PCA or predicted PCA, it will tell you whether you use integrated K and what devices you've used on that little line over there next to the lens that you've selected. So it's an alternative to theoretical prediction. As yet, it's not proved to be better, but it's certainly equivalent, could be more useful in unusual corneas. And we've spoken about the K calculator and the integrated. So when you use all these measures, this is my own data, 289 hours, about 81% within a half double. This is actual outcome, not predicted outcome, actual outcome, 81%. It's a bit better today, it's more like 83-84% actual outcomes. Because what I showed you before was based on not where I think the lens is going to sit, where the lens is sitting, using post-op K's, not pre-op K's. So one of the confounding factors is SIA. So your actual outcomes may not be as good as your predicted outcomes, for instance. Anyway, when I look at my T2 cases, so that's T2 to T7. When I look at my T2 cases, and I look at the percentage within a half doctor of actual outcomes, guess what? It's 91% within a half doctor. Because any misalignment is not an issue, or much less of an issue than with high cylinders. So the other myth I want to dispel, a very important one, is that when you have low levels of astigmatism, you should do incisions. That toric IOLs aren't suitable for low levels of astigmatism. It's the opposite. Not only are they suitable, they're indispensable. So unfortunately, there's a feeling, oh, it's a low level, I'll just use incisions. What I'm saying to you is I disagree with that 100%. For low levels of astigmatism, consider low cylinder toric IOLs. And we are lucky in the Asia Pacific because guess what? We've got low levels. We've got T2. Not every country has T2. So I used to do lots of incisions, astigmatic keratitis, limbal relaxing incisions. I had my own method for doing it. I had my own algorithms. I would not dream of doing an incision today. They cause dry eye, irritation, they're unstable. So what you get in a week, month may not be the same as you get at 6 months. And most importantly, they're unpredictable. And why are they unpredictable? Take a simple incision, like a keratome, 2.4 millimeter keratome formed at the same location. Plot the surgical induced astigmatism, the X and Y vectors on a double angle plot, and look at the result. It's all over the place. The magnitude, the mean magnitude, may be about 0.35. But you've got to take into account where has that occurred. It doesn't stay in the line of the incision as you think. It varies. So you've got to take the geometric mean of all those vectors. That's called the centroid. It takes into account not just the magnitude of the direction. So when you add them all up, guess what you get? About 0.1. So if you're using 0.3 or 0.4 or 0.5 as your SIA, it's wrong. Don't do it. You can calculate your own, but it's going to be close to 0.1. It's not that it's negligible. It's because the direction is unpredictable. And the best thing you can do in general is to use the one that's going to do the least harm, which is the mean, simple value, which is 0.1. So use that as the SIA in the barotonic calculator. Best thing I can say is don't chase the steep axis. It just causes noise. Operate on a consistent axis, temporal, as small as you can, or comfortable with, 2.4 or less. And as I said, use a centroid value for SIA when you use the toric calculator. If you're using a toric calculator, which is not taking the posterior corner into account, again, it doesn't matter what you put in for SIA, because it's so noisy anyway. You're only predicting 30% in a half doctor. So you may have got away with it. But when you're using a more predictable toric calculator, it's more important that you put in a value for SIA which reflects the reality, and that's about 0.1. So that brings us to alignment. I won't spend too much time on alignment, but just to say there's many different devices today. There's computerized image guided, there's avalometers that can help determine alignment, and it can also be a bit intimidating because, you know, you're thinking about toric lenses and you say, oh my gosh, what about all this technology? Are these devices really necessary? The most common method is just to mark the cornea by direct visualization, 180 degrees, and use that reference axis to determine the toric IOL axis for alignment. So you mark your reference meridian and then you use some marker or gauge to work out where the toric lens should be sitting. But it assumes that your reference axis is 180 degrees. And that's not always the case, even with the slip track, even with gravity devices. So my approach to that is mark where you think 180 degrees, and then you can use an app I developed called Toricam. Let's see if that works. And it's not working. So what this app does, when you mark, you take a picture of the eye. It uses the accelerometer within your iPhone and will tell you exactly what your reference axis actually is. I'm just going to have to go out there and go back because it's frozen again. I apologize for that. Ron, why don't you just ask a question while I quickly sort that out?
Those of you who are using toric lenses, how many of you actually use the industry or the manufacturer's toric calculator? Like there's Alcon, is the calculator, Zeiss. So you're all using the industry supplied calculator. And I'll tell you why it's okay, but you can do better. And you can do better because Graham's updates are all on the APACRS version of it. And although Graham supplies it to industry, it takes them probably 6 to 12 months before, like, the integrated K calculator is not in industry calculators. It's in the APACRS one. Graham, you ready?
Yeah. So what you do then, the best way to apply that information, you don't have to, but there's a special toric marker called the Barrett Dual Axis marker, no financial interest in the app or the marker. But what's nice about this, we can set the reference axis from the app independently from the toric axis from the calculator. So you can then just apply this, match up the little reference marks to your blue marks on your eye, and the lens will be exactly where it should be. That's opened up with McKinney. So I looked at a friend of mine who uses image guided, and that's the blue dots. And you can see it's pretty good, but you can see there's these outliers. Anyone who uses image-guided devices will know that occasionally it just gives you the wrong result, and you don't often know. With the Toricam is the red, so the mean absolute error in toric misalignment is actually less using the app than using the image-guided system. So it's not a perfect study because it's different people doing it, but for me, I would use always both systems. So I do use image guided, either correctly. crystal, Varium. I always use the app as well. Is anything you do in Torix, you check twice, and you do your case twice. You check your calculation, maybe PCA, measured empirical. And for me, I do my alignment twice, both with the app as well as the ImageGuard. Because ImageGuard is nice in that it's really efficient. Your time is taken in the office rather than in the OR. So I do both. But it's not necessary if you don't have any diagnosis. You'll get very accurate outcomes using manual marking, especially with something like the app. So when to use Torix IOLs? So you should know that 0.75 doctors of residual astigmatism has got worse blur, more defocus than 0.7 doctors of spherical defocus. I use lasers pretty much like the distribution, the normal population. It matches the distribution of the normal population. Now, 80% of your patients who present for surgery have more than a half diopter astigmatism when they present. Most people think about a half diopter is about the level which begins to impact visual acuity. But here's another myth I want to dispel, and that there is no toric required for low levels of astigmatism. Because your method of prediction has a mean absolute error of 1.3, a standard deviation, if you want all your patients to end up within a half diopter, and I'll explain why you should want that, what you have to target? You have to target zero. It's no different than your sphere. If you want your patients to end up less than a half diopter or spherical error from a spherical point of view, you target close to zero. Same thing applies when you look at a stick. If you want your patients to end up less than a half, you have to target pretty much close to zero for all your patients. So you have to do a toric calculation essentially on all your patients. If you look at my T2, when you look at their astigmatism prior to surgery, there's actually two groups. There's the Whipple rule, about 1.43, and the Genser rule, the mean is about 0.57, and many patients have zero astigmatism, keratometric astigmatism. But they still end up with a T2. And both groups do well. You can see that with the rule, 86% within a half against the rule, 83% within a half. And you can do an analysis and say, well, what would have happened if I hadn't used the T2 on those patients? And if you didn't use a T2, you had a bit of time, again, only 20% would have ended up within a half. And if you use a T3, only 54%. Just showing you the utility of a low cylinder toric IOL. So it's a bit like astigmatism. It's in the eye of the beholder. When you look at that picture, what do you see? Something attractive or something less attractive? You see something attractive. I always see it looking quite attractive, but if you look hard, you'll see there's another way to look at that same picture. Anyway, so in Europe, guess what? The percentage of toric IOLs of monofocals is 3.5%. In Australia, in 2016, it was 29%, and now it's about 50%. A huge difference. And T2s and T3s in Europe, 30% of toric lenses. In Australia, 60%. So there's a difference in patterns in different countries. In the US, a little bit better, but not much. 10% of monofocal products, and they don't have a T2, so the T3 is 39%. Well, when I look back, when I began cataract surgery, and I began with Intracat back in the early 80s, three doctors was fine. You didn't flinch when the patient had three doctors after cataract surgery. And as we moved to Extracat, we tightened up our expectations that about one and a half doctors was acceptable. But really today, as we're getting very close to 2020, you remember it will be in Singapore, AACRS, with today's precision that we have, with perfect precision, I really think that we should target for all our patients to end up with less than a half doctor astigmatism. You know, there's nothing special about astigmatic defocus. Defocus is defocus. it's blur. So it's like the idea that blur due to astigmatism doesn't matter, now you have to worry about spherical blur, doesn't make sense. So I hope that the presentation today, by dispelling some of the myths, that there's any use in meeting patients with astigmatism, some of the myths about measurements, some of the myths about when to use low-toric lenses, helps you also get better outcomes and plot the right course for your patients. So thank you very much for your attention.